A little bit. My name is Stephen Pynakker of Mormon Book Reviews. That's the name of my YouTube channel. And the name of this presentation is An Evangelical Encounters the Book of Mormon and the Restoration. So I just want to start off, give some background. So ever since I was a young child, I was very spiritually minded and always felt, I don't know, I guess you could say led of the Lord. And I just want you guys to understand a little bit about what kind of background I have in regards to being I'm from like Dutch Reformed stock, you know, on both sides. So that would be the traditional background. My grandfather comes from a farmer, and my father, my mother's side is farmer, and my dad's side came from the city of Chicago. So you have a mixture of the two different Dutch communities. But starting in the late 60s, early 70s, we had what was called the Charismatic Renewal Movement, which really exploded across all the particular denominations of Protestantism, as well as within Catholicism. So my father was head of a group called the Full Gospel Businessmen's Association, which was very instrumental in bringing about a lot of ecumenical and unity into the church. And so I was raised in a household in which miracles happened, and people spoke with angels, and people had visions. So a lot of the things that I read about within Mormonism, those things don't scare me. And so I think it's really important that the context of the era that my parents raised in was in 1975, you had the Worldwide Church of God, the Jehovah's Witnesses, both predicting that the world was going to be coming to an end in 1975. The best-selling book of the 1970s was called The Late Great Planet Earth the number one selling book was The Late Great Planet Earth, which was an evangelical book about the end of the world. Hal Lindsey wrote that book. So there was an expectation at this time with the charismatic movement, we were at the end of the road here, that the second coming was imminent. And so, and just so I'll give you some context for some of those who are based out of Salt Lake City or that your church headquarters is, my parents, I remember seeing the survival food that they had in their garage. So they were kind of like preppers. So even a similarity there with the Salt Lake branch. So I think all these things kind of prepared me for this kind of interesting thing. So as a young child, I was very spiritually minded, but I also sometimes thought that, you know, people aren't reading the Bible and the gospel isn't being shared with people. And I sometimes wondered, I wonder if we need a Bible for modern times. That was an idea that I thought as a child. So the fact that a young man in the 1800s thought the same thing and also encountered, as the history tells us, new scripture. I also realized that the evangelical notion that the canon is closed is a Catholic doctrine, and there's nothing in scripture that does close the canon. So that was later in life, but I realized that that was not an issue. So let me explain to you my first encounter with the Book of Mormon, which was at a Marriott hotel. And I want to specifically show this edition of the Book of Mormon, because this is actually a relatively rare edition. This came out in 1980, and I remember the cover, but I could never find it anywhere. But then I went on a Book of Mormon editions YouTube channel, and he talked about how this is a relatively rare edition. So it kind of dates it. This is 1980. So thereabouts, probably I was about 7, maybe 8 years old. I'm not really sure when this would have been. If so, it would have been the early 80s. And I encountered a Book of Mormon. And one of the things that really struck me was the imagery of the Book of Mormon. So imagine this young kid who is taught all these Bible stories, okay? And he sees something like, I'm sorry, my assistant cut him off, but of course, here's Jesus appearing to the new world. And I look at this and I'm thinking, well, this looks like the second coming happening during the Old Testament. So it's kind of confusing to my young mind, you know, what is this, what's the story going on here? And of course, then you have the battles where you have the Samuel, the Lamanite, And in this case, you have the bad Nephites, if you will, going after Samuel the Lamanite. And so that was kind of a stunning image to me, just to see these two particular ones really stuck with me. And so as a child, I went to my parents and asked them, what is this Book of Mormon? I don't understand what this is all about. And of course, their standard answer was, well, this is like a different church. They have a different Bible, and they're based out in Salt Lake City. they didn't really know anything about the Mormons, but the idea really stuck with me and really intrigued me. And I like to point out this particular painting on the end here, because this was not in that edition. This was not painted by Arnold Freiberg. Of course, Arnold Freiberg, very important character. You guys, well, some of you, you know, obviously this is the Utah branch. So just to give you a background on Arnold Freiberg, he's very influential in the imagery of the Utah view of who, what Nephi looked like, what Lehi looked like. But also he was actually very instrumental in creating the aesthetic of the great movie, The Ten Commandments, with Charlton Heston in the 1950s. He was Cecil B. DeMille's art, kind of like he was the person who came up with the concepts of how the look of The Ten Commandments. And actually Cecil B. DeMille wanted to make a Book of Mormon movie. That's how impressed he was by Arnold Freiberg and what he was doing. But this painting here on the far right of Moroni burying the plates, okay? If I had seen that when I was 7 or 8 years old, I really am convinced that I would have been, I joke, I probably would have been converted right on the spot, because it was so earnest and spoke to me in a very powerful way. So that's just a little bit about how the imagery, because, you know, as a child, images and pictures are going to be more influential than necessarily the words. So that was just something that was in the back of my head. And then I'm just going to go back. So, and then my other encounter with Mormonism was in the early 80s, the Channel 38 in Chicago, which was about the largest Christian television station in the country, ran the Godmakers. And I saw all the Godmakers cartoon, and that left an real impact, but that was, you know, spiritual propaganda. There was nothing, no truth to that, but I do remember encountering the cartoon as a young child. So that was my image of Mormonism, was a distorted one through the Godmakers and these images from the Book of Mormon. And my parents kind of just a stereotypical view of something that they didn't really know much about. So the very first time that I had where I really delved into the Book of Mormon with another person was when I interviewed Christopher Thomas, the author of A Pentecostal Reads the Book of Mormon, A Literary and Theological Introduction. And Christopher Thomas is probably one of the top two or three Pentecostal theologians in the world. I mean, I just found out recently he's Princeton educated and everything like that. So he did this real in-depth study of the Book of Mormon. And it's he takes the text very seriously. He's not there to mock. He's there to really look at it as a literary critic and take and look at the text and what is the text saying. So it dawned on me after I'd done this stuff with him that it's like, well, this is the first time I ever actually had an in-depth conversation with somebody about the Book of Mormon. Well, I think that kind of leads to kind of some of my, what I want to discuss about the Book of Mormon, and that is what this evangelical finds accessible in the Book of Mormon. And I'll say this in particular, I probably should have said what a evangelical may find accessible, because some of this is what I would find accessible, and then what other evangelicals as a whole would find accessible. Well, first of all, Jesus saturates the Book of Mormon. Jesus saturates it in such a way that that the Old Testament, there are types and shadows of Christ in the Old Testament. Now, I personally, since a young age, kind of think that Melchizedek might have been Christ in the Bible. So I do think that might have been a pre-incarnate Christ. But the idea that people were calling themselves Christians and they were building churches before the time of Christ, you know, of course, it's kind of jarring, right, to somebody who understands, you know, the traditional narrative of church history. But I like the fact that Jesus is in the Book of Mormon. I say the Book of Mormon is more Trinitarian than much of the Bible. Now, most theologians, when they look at the Book of Mormon, they would say that it's more modulistic than Trinity. I mean, it's a form of Trinitarian, which would be modulism, which was considered a heresy back in the day. But it's still more Trinitarian than much of the Bible. Now, the most recognizable Trinitarian verse in the New Testament is in the Book of John. And it's interesting because that particular Trinitarian scripture was not in the original manuscripts. As a matter of fact, it was added in by Erasmus when some people were saying, hey, why don't you have this the Trinitarian formula in here? And he said, well, because it's not in the Greek. So get me a Greek manuscript and I'll put it in there. Well, somebody, I guess, apparently just made up a Greek manuscript and put it in there. So it's interesting that for a long period of time, at least what the scholars are saying is that Trinitarian verse, and I wish I had put it in there and I apologize for that, but it's a familiar one, was not in the New Testament. So very interesting there. The other thing that I find accessible in this, in the broadest sense, and also how an evangelical would find it accessible, is that there's very little Mormon doctrine in the Book of Mormon. And when I say that, you know, most evangelicals think that baptism for the dead and plurality of gods and so many of the doctrines that make the Salt Lake, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints so unique to not only to Protestants, for a lot of evangelicals who don't really understand, what this is all about, a lot of Mormon doctrine is kind of scary to people. When I try to explain to them, you know, the Book of Mormon has very little Mormonism in it. Now, moving on to my next point is it has a very high view of scripture. Now, when I say that, I'm speaking, this is more like as how would an evangelical in general, how would they appreciate the Book of Mormon? Well, in one sense, it does have a high view of scripture. Why do I say that? Well, it takes the Bible literally, right? In other words, there was a Tower of Babel, right? And that the Jaredites fled from. And so somebody who like takes the Bible very literally in the evangelical camp, that's interesting that it takes the Bible literally. It also, in one sense, solves the Isaiah problem, right? So if the Book of Mormon were found to be true, right? Like if there's the consensus comes out that, hey, this is a legitimate ancient document. Well, we have like a defense of the Book of Isaiah. And the reason I explain that in modern scholarship, most modern scholars say that I think maybe up to 4 or 5 different Isaiahs, okay? And so most modern scholars say the Book of Isaiah wasn't written by Isaiah. And then it was written over the course of many years, over different periods of time by different authors. So the problem is that when Lehi and his crew flee Jerusalem and they have their scriptures, right, that they take with them, they have the whole of the Book of Isaiah with them. So again, in other words, they believe that Isaiah wrote Isaiah. The Book of Mormon assumes that Isaiah wrote the Book of Isaiah, right? So I find that to be just an interesting thing. And I try to tell people, my evangelical friends, I said, you realize that if the Book of Mormon were to be proven to be true, that it actually would do more to help strengthen the Bible than anything. So it shouldn't be, in other words, don't be threatened by it, right? Because there's very little in there that the actual, you know, text and what's in the Book of Mormon should not be a scary thing to an evangelical. I also like the ongoing story within the Book of Mormon is about how people when they're right with God and they are people that are united and they're looking out for one another and they're living Christ-like and following the scriptures and the law of Moses and everything like that, that society can function. There can be harmony in that society and the people will prosper. But then it shows that if you turn your back on God, then bad things will happen. And that's kind of an ongoing theme throughout the Book of Mormon. I mean, if anything, it's trying to tell you anything. Don't turn your back on God, right? Well, as an evangelical, why would they have a problem with that, right? And so now this is the other thing too, like, okay, if we want to look at it metaphorically, like let's say I'm talking to John Hamer, right? Well, if you go and turn your back on your moral and ethical core, you know, the fiber of who you are as an individual, guess what? Bad thing's going to happen. So it can be viewed metaphorically. It can be viewed literally. And that's how scripture actually should be read. It should be read in different levels. Like Origen advocated that. I think that's a way of looking at it. So I like that. And one thing I forgot to add onto my list, but I come from the evangelical camp that we believe in, having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, having a born again experience. And we believe in what's called believer's baptism, right? Well, what is one of the things that the Book of Mormon makes it very clear? Infant baptism is no, there's no infant baptism. That's not allowed. That's a great, terrible thing to do, to practice. And so, I just think that that's kind of like it from my camp, my particular camp within evangelicalism, because there are some evangelicals that don't have a problem or actually advocate on behalf of infant baptism. So here we go to what are the stumbling blocks that this evangelical or evangelicals in general might encounter. Well, first of all, I think the top one would be the Book of Mormon teaches a fortunate fall. Now, the idea of a fortunate fall is not necessarily foreign to Christianity. Of course, we have Milton in Paradise Lost. He talks about it, and it's an intriguing idea. And then throughout Christian history, there have been people who have this idea that there was, quote unquote, a fortunate fall, is not necessarily foreign to Christianity, but it's definitely something, it's kind of a fringe out there position, but it's not entirely foreign to Christianity, but generally speaking, the fall, you know, I went to an old school Christian school, right? It was by Dutch Reformed people who became charismatics, okay? So this is a very conservative school. We were taught by McGuffey readers in kindergarten, okay? And when they do the alphabet, it says, the very first is A, at Adam's fall, we sinned all. And that's what we are taught in the McGuffey readers. This was, that was a phraseology that they used. And so that's foundational to Protestantism, right? Is the idea of original sin, and that at the fall of Adam, that this was a great tragedy. Now, this is something that shouldn't be looked at as fortunate, but should be looked at as something that's really tragic. And that would be the traditional Protestant as well as the Catholic position. And so we don't look at anything very fortunate about the fall. We also feel that what Christ had to do to come and redeem mankind was to reverse the effects of this great sin that happened, and then what Christ did at the redemption. So that's a stumbling block. Now, when I was talking to Patrick McKay, he did tell me, he said, well, we do believe that we have fallen natures. I'm like, okay, I can work with that, right? If you have fallen natures, and I can understand too, like, well, how is it that because Adam and Eve partook of a particular piece of fruit, that somehow condemns me to eternal damnation, right? That's an understandable thing. I get that. And so I can work with that, right? Another one would be because I come from a traditional Protestant background, but I've since kind of moved on to obviously a much different direction than the rest of my peers, is that the Book of Mormon teaches works-based salvation. Most notably, after all that we can do, we are saved by grace through Christ after all that we can do. Okay, so the traditional understanding of the Reformation is that we're saved through grace alone, through faith alone. And this is like foundational to the Protestantism as well to the evangelical movement as a whole and charismatic, generally speaking. They all embrace the idea that we're saved through grace alone, through faith alone in Christ, okay? Saying that verse, after all that we can do, I don't know what to do with that. But I will tell you that we also have the book of James in our Bible, and it says faith without works is dead, right? So a lot of Protestant reformers like to ignore that verse. As a matter of fact, Luther said the book of James is a straw gospel. Like he would, if he had his way, Luther would have thrown that thing out, okay? But it was there and he had to deal with it. And Calvinists and people who believe in justification through faith alone, you have to accept the fact that that is in the book of James. So that sounds a lot like after all we can do, right? So then this is the one that kind of really gets me, and I'd like to have maybe a conversation with you all about this after the thing, and that is the idea that the appearance of Christ in the Book of Mormon seems to undermine his work in the old world. Feels like an Old Testament story. Let me explain to you why. What Jesus did at the cross was that that was the beginning of the redemption of all creation as a result of what happened at the fall, okay? And when Jesus came, the veil was torn at the time, at this period of time during the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. The veil was torn. The idea that all people, all the entire world, the entire creation it can have access to the Savior, that it's no longer just for a chosen people, but it's for all of people. And that the way that God would deal with his people, being all of humanity now, would be different than how Yahweh dealt with them in the Old Testament, you know, through destruction and through wars and all these things that are very commonplace, because the book, the Old Testament is obviously a very bloody document, just like the Book of Mormon is, especially during the war chapters. But when he comes to the New World, as the narrative goes, you have the 3 days of darkness, you have this destruction, you have cities being destroyed, you just have this, it's an apocalyptic story. It just doesn't seem to mesh with the Jesus and his ministry of what he was doing in the new world. And it wasn't just for the new world, but it was for all of creation. Okay. And so for then him to go to the new world and act like Yahweh more than Jesus is something that is a stumbling block. It would be a stumbling block to most Protestants. And it is something in the back of my mind. It's like, yeah, that Jesus that comes back to the new world initially. And this is the thing, because this is the initial thing. You have the destruction, you have like, you know, woe unto you, and all these cities are being, and it's like, okay, this sounds like apocalyptic and Old Testament. Doesn't sound like what Jesus is, just right after Jesus has finished work at the cross. It just seems to contradict that Christ. That's all, that's just my perception on it. Now I'll give you guys an out on this, because I do believe I'm working on it. This is kind of an ad hoc thing where I'm thinking like, okay, a lot of people don't realize, but the destruction of the temple in AD 70 is something that is very, very important in the New Testament, and it looms very large. Now, whether you are somebody who believes that much of the New Testament was written before the destruction or after the destruction, it's irrelevant. The destruction of the temple is a big deal in the New Testament. Now, with Jesus in Matthew, he talks about there are those who are here, that this generation will not come to pass. We'll see these things happen within this generation. Well, biblical generation is 40 years. This is approximately AD 30 when Jesus's ministry is going on. And exactly 40 years later, a biblical generation, we have the destruction of the temple. So the idea of the birth, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, and then the destruction of the temple are, I mean, the destruction of the temple is just like one step below, because this, the idea that the abode of God, where God dwelt on planet Earth, was destroyed. So that's an apocalyptic, that's the apocalypse right there in one sense, is the destruction of the temple. So I will say, maybe that's a way you can make it work, that Jesus was kind of, when he came to the new world, he was kind of combining the destruction of the temple with his finished work at the cross. That's an ad hoc argument, but I think there's something you can work with there. Okay, so here's the traditional thing. the Book of Mormon seems to reflect 19th century Americana, right? And to an outsider, it does appear to do that. You know, we have the famous quote from Alexander Campbell about how basically this seems to resolve every argument that's going on in this part of the country and the burned over district. All the arguments are settled, the modes of baptism and all this kind of stuff. You know, so that's the argument that was early on. As a matter of fact, that was like the first evangelical criticism of the Book of Mormon, was Alexander Campbell's expose on it, you know, just talking about this, the 19th century Americana in the book. Now, you know, Jonathan Neville, and I'll get to his book in a second, in his newest book called Infinite Goodness, Joseph Smith, Jonathan Edwards, and the Book of Mormon, he accepts the idea that 19th century anachronisms and stuff would be in there, because Joseph Smith was a translator, and he would be translating in a world that exists around him. So the translator is going to be influenced by the outside if you're doing like a traditional translation, you know, where you're working off the text and you're translating right to another language. So when you're trying to find words, you know, this is the the idea of not having a seer stone, but the original idea of using the interpreters and doing the translation idea of the Book of Mormon. So like, the analogy would be like in the Renaissance period, a lot of the paintings of biblical scenes often were people were dressed in the garb of their period of time. The armor of the soldiers was, they were wearing that garb. So the idea that as they were translating, if you will, the stories of the Bible, they were also bringing in their world into those paintings, okay? And so that kind of can explain the 19th century, but there are issues there, okay? I'm not trying to, but I do think that that's an explanation that I think could maybe help in that regard. And so then there's the finding of the plates and the process of translation. Now, the process of translation would be the idea of the using the seer stone, right? To a lot of evangelicals, the idea that something like an occultic practice being used to create divine scripture, especially to a modern evangelical, they would find very disturbing. Also, the finding of the plates, right? The story, like, okay, how is this? This farm boy finds these plates, and I mean, it does, you know, I mean, it's like, yeah, okay, is this just a tall tale, right? Is this some kind of frontier tall tale of this semi-literate farm boy finding these plates? And then he's just kind of, he's a great storyteller, and he creates this document, right? So, but I do want to say that in defense, is I want to give you guys some context. Now, my grandfather ended up having one of the largest plumbing distributor. He's one of the largest plumbing distributors in the Midwest. The company still exists to this day, but he started off with doing drilling for wells. Okay. Now, my grandfather originally was from Chicago, and then the Canadian government sent a lot of people down to the Roseland area of Chicago was of the primary Dutch community, and they wanted Dutch people to come up and farm their land. So my grandfather went to Western Canada. So he's on the frontier. The world that he lived in and grew up in was very similar to the world that Joseph Smith grew in. Now, this was a century later, but still was very similar. And I'm getting to a point here. So my grandfather starts a well digging business. And he also has a plumbing business, and then it became a plumbing distribution business. Well, I just remember going through old calendars that they used to put out like in the 50s and 60s. And in these calendars, they had astrological symbols, a lot of cultic stuff, right? And this is a Christian man who actually had an encounter with, my grandfather had an encounter with an angel. This angel came to him and said that his business was going to succeed and that he would be blessed. And then he walks down the street and then this angel disappears. This is the story my grandpa tells me. This is part of our family lore. That's just part of my life and how it goes. So, but he was a religious man and a Christian man, but he still used occultic stuff in his calendars. Now, if you go into the stores now and ask for a calendar, it's gonna all have Bible verses in it, right? So I just wanted to give you context that Joseph did grow up in a different time and place. And the idea that, and just to give you an idea, it was a well digger, they used dowsing rods, okay, to find the water. So the world my grandfather inhabited was very similar to the world that Joseph inhabited. So I feel a connection there. And I think evangelicals do themselves a disservice by not realizing that many of their brethren were also doing the same thing that Joseph were, and that they had a similar background in culture as well. So I'm just getting back to this idea of infinite goodness, Joseph Smith, Jonathan Edwards, and the Book of Mormon. So I interviewed, my second interview with Jonathan Neville was discussing the influence of Jonathan Edwards on the document. Now, because he believes he was a translator, he believes that when he was, after his surgery, and he was staying at an uncle's, and he was immobile, he believes that he was exposed to the writings of Jonathan Edwards. So what he did was he did a Google word analysis of the Book of Mormon and found, okay, what are all the phrases and verses that are in the Bible that are also in the Book of Mormon? And then he said, okay, what are all the phrases and stuff that are in the Book of Mormon that aren't in the Bible, right? So then he does this word analysis and finds that he keeps on getting back to Jonathan Edwards. So he believes as a translator, he was heavily influenced because he said, I was intimately acquainted with the clergy of the time. Well, he feels that he was intimately acquainted through them, through their writings. And so here we have Jonathan Edwards. Okay, so, and this is the thing. The natural man is an enemy to God. That's not in the Bible. Jonathan Edwards used that phrase. And there are other many phrases that Jonathan Edwards used that make itself into the Book of Mormon. As an evangelical, Jonathan Edwards in the Book of Mormon, I kind of like that. So then I just want to read you my review that I gave on the Book of Mormon for my podcast. An evangelical reviews his books of Mormon. The actual physical copy of a Book of Mormon had a profound effect on me as a young child. From the Arnold Freiberg paintings to the idea of new scripture for our time sparked my imagination. The Book of Mormon is an audacious enterprise, whether it was the product of a clever farm boy or a modern prophet of the Lord. The book has been mocked and ridiculed from the very beginning, but in its own way has stood the test of time. It is time for evangelicals to put aside their stereotypes and prejudices and truly engage the text, and more importantly, the believers of this book. So I think that's what's also important too. You know, as a evangelical, we're all about having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ and having Jesus as the center of your life. And so anybody that confesses with their mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, and we have a book that purports to be scripture found by this young farm boy that says Jesus Christ is Lord. Okay, I don't have a problem with that. So I wanna just put out a few shout outs and I'm winding down, but I got a few more minutes here. I want to put out a few things to a couple guys, because with my channel, when I first started, the very first person, I got a call from Patrick McKay, and he called me, and because Paul, Okay. Paul Ludi. I got it right. I got it pronounced right. Paul Ludi said, you need to talk to Patrick. So I ordered, because I was ordering some books from Paul Ludi, because Barbara Walden of the Community of Christ said, hey, if you need to get a copy of the Joseph Smith III biography, Paul Ludi might have a copy. So I bought a used copy from him. And he said, you need to talk to Patrick. Well, then Patrick called me on a Saturday night and we had a wonderful, wonderful conversation. You have to understand the trajectory of my channel was to be more secular and scholarly in nature, but Patrick introduced a more spiritual dimension and it affected me. And of course, right? I mean, I'm dealing with a major religion and we sometimes people who are kind of like the anthropologists and the scholars, they don't look at the spiritual. They don't even take into account. Well, that's to their loss because the spiritual is foundational to who we are as human beings. Whether you believe in God or not, we're all hardwired to be spiritual. That's just who we are, right? So I think embracing the spiritual and integrating into my channel is like fundamentally important. And then there's Rick Bennett, who just has taken me under his wing and has done a wonderful thing for me in helping me with the launching of my channel and doing a joint production with his Gospel Tangents podcast. I got on the phone with him and 2 hours later, he agreed to come on my show and we've become very close friends since. And then I want to feature my friend, Christopher Thomas, who's one of the top Pentecostal theologians in the world and wrote that wonderful book, A Pentecostal Reads the Book of Mormon. And he is fascinated by the Book of Mormon. And I should have gotten to this early, but essentially there's two things that Christopher discovered about the Book of Mormon. And that was it's full of Pentecostal doctrine. The idea of baptism by fire with evidence of tongues is something that comes out of Azusa Street in 1906. That's a doctrine that was developed and is unique to the Pentecostal movement from a little over 100 years ago, but it found its way into the Book of Mormon 70 years or so before the Azusa Street revival. So he's truly fascinated by that as a Pentecostal. How is a key Pentecostal doctrine making itself into the Book of Mormon? Also, well, I would love to tell you about his discovery about the anti-Nephi. Oh my goodness, I'm messing this one up. You guys know what I'm talking about. But he found something very interesting about that as well in the book, which is also fascinating. Anti-Lehi. Oh no. Okay, I'm not going to try. So I'm sorry, guys. Sometimes I'm going to butcher it. It's not the world I grew up in. So I just want to thank what I would call kind of my personal trinity, if you will, of friends who helped launch this channel. He was my first book review. Rick was my first interview. So I got the theologian, I have the friend, and I have a man who is a spiritual man. So it's just a wonderful endeavor with you. So where has my journey taken me? Well, I started off with the idea of starting a small YouTube channel of a subject I really enjoyed. During this journey, I have met many wonderful people, from the Community of Christ to the Restoration Branches to the Church of Jesus Christ, all the way to the Church of Jesus Christ, all have shown kindness to a stranger, a very Christ-like attribute. Thank you for welcoming me into your communities. I just wanted to show you this picture. I attended in just outside of Tarpon Springs, Florida, and it's about an hour and 20 minute drive from where I live in Florida. I had the opportunity to visit your the Pentecostal branch, although Patrick will tell me that all restorationists are Pentecostals, that the Church of Jesus Christ warmly embraced me. And about a half dozen people came up to me and said, we love your YouTube channel, we love your videos. I was blown away by that. The first restorationist church that I stepped foot in, and they already knew who I was. And that had to do with Patrick, because he was friends with a lot of people in that church. So I had a wonderful church service. It lasted 3 hours. It seemed like it was 45 minutes long. I had a wonderful time affiliating. So I think that this church in particular, and they believe, okay, they love Jesus, they love the Bible, and they love the Book of Mormon. And these are precious people. And I felt very comfortable and very much at home. And if the Book of Mormon can produce a people like that, that are loving and wonderful, and also very accessible to most. I'm going to take about 2 or 3 people from my community to worship with them this fall when I get back to into my area that I'm heading out of town tomorrow. So, but this is just kind of a really cool experience. So I went from just doing a secular scholarly thing to ended up attending services and worshiping in a restorationist church, and it was a wonderful time had by all. And this all had to do with because this young boy encountered around the age of 7 or 8, these Arnold Freiberg paintings of the Book of Mormon, and that planted a seed that caused me to then end up at the pulpit or right by their altar and being able to share with these people a wonderful experience. So again, my name is Stephen Pynakker. The name of my channel is Mormon Book Reviews. I have my contact information up there. So my email is up there. That's linked to my YouTube channel. My website is still GoDaddy right now, but the actual name is going to be mormonbookreviews.com. I just got to upgrade to a different package too, so that it's that. So I just have to, I haven't gotten around to do that. And then friend me on Facebook. That's my Facebook link as well. Also, one more thing. The fourth book review I ever did was on Joseph Smith III. And for whatever reason, nobody's watching that video. That becomes my dead last video every time. Like it will be, I'll release a new video and within a day, a few days or a week, that video will pass it up. And I'm like, guys, give my Joseph Smith III, especially you Community of Christ people, give that video some love and watch it, please, because I think I did a pretty good job with it. But either way, I want to thank you all. I'll open it up for any questions. And I do appreciate this opportunity that Paul gave me. And I want to say, too, I listed 3 people, but, you know, Paul and so many other people have just been wonderful. It would take me probably 20 minutes to thank all the people of the restoration that have meant so much to me and have just been so precious to me. And I'm very excited about this endeavor. And I have some wonderful guests lined up. And again, just thank you for your time. And that's it. That's my presentation.